Absolutely.
Just like to check your name. Marcin Papszycki.
Papszycki. Marcin Papszycki. Papszycki.
Right. I'd like first to introduce the second presenter, Professor Marcin Papszycki. So Professor Marcin Papszycki is an associate professor at the Sisens Research Institute of the Polish Academy of Sciences. He has a Master of Science from the Adam Mickiewicz University in Poznan, Poland, a PhD from the Southwest Methodist University in Dallas, Texas, and a Doctor of Science from the Bulgarian Academy of Science. He is a senior member of the IEEE, a senior member of the ACM, a senior Fulbright lecturer, and an IEEE Computer Science Distinguished Visitor. He has contributed to more than 450 publications and was invited to the program committees of over 500 international conferences. He is on the editorial board of 12 journals and book series. So I'd like again to thank Professor Marcin Papszycki for the presentation. So thank you. Let me pass the word to you, please.
Thank you. I think we can go a little bit down with the voice. Test. A little bit lower. Okay. Thank you. I usually don't use microphone, but after 19 hours of traveling, somehow I feel that if I do my usual presentation, my voice will completely give out. And I know then, of course, there would be the caipirinha cure, because I heard that here in Brazil you have this very magical drink, which is named caipirinha. You drink it and it cures all kinds of diseases, okay? So whenever you are having some kind of illness, you just have another glass of caipirinha and you survive. So, but I will try to avoid this. My presentation will be a little bit away from the main topic of the conference, because I wanted to talk to you a little bit about semantic technologies, and my talk will be followed by my colleague, Professor Maria Ganja, who will also talk about semantic technologies. This will be, in a way, an extension to showing you that there is another part to life other than power systems, and also it has application to power systems and networks. So what I wanted to tell you a little bit about is related to Internet of Things. And how many of you do research? Because I know that there are some people here who do research in the Internet of Things. Who is doing research in the Internet of Things? Raise your hands, please. Okay, very good. Who knows what Internet of Things is? Okay, and who is participating in Internet of Things? Sorry, wrong answer, because all of you are. You don't believe me? Okay, how many of you have smartphones? Raise your hands. Who has a smartphone? How many sensors are there in your smartphones? Okay, in average, standard smartphone has more than 10, typically around 13 sensors, which means that each and every one of you using 13 sensors at least is generating data for some form of Internet of Things. Because what is Internet of Things? Internet of Things are sensors and actuators, okay? So if there are sensors on your devices, you are generating data. Of course, it means that your data is typically going to Korea, fortunately to South Korea, not to North Korea, even though if it goes to South Korea, most likely it's hacked by North Koreans and it goes to North Korea, or to China. I have a Xiaomi phone, and this is not an advertisement for Xiaomi company, unfortunately. I wish they sponsored my trip, but they don't. But because I would then be coming business class on expenses of Xiaomi, which I am not. But Xiaomi, all of my data goes to Mi Cloud. Where is Mi Cloud? Someplace in China. And knowing China, probably right now, first secretary of Chinese Communist Party is looking and saying, Papshitsky, you are not walking enough, because I also have Mi Band, and my Mi Band is telling that I'm not walking enough, so the Communist Party will send me an SMS, Papshitsky, start moving around because you're going to get fat. Yes. They have this platform that every citizen will be controlled by the Chinese government. If you don't believe me, you may want to check it out. So there will be points, and probably if you are, everything will be grivalization. I mean, it's like playing games. So gamification of things. So all your life will be now a game. If you make 5 steps more than your colleague, you're going to get another Qingdao beer or something like this in China. Or maybe in Brazil with your new president, you're going to get like a shot of caipirinha if in your company you are the winner of the walking competition. And they will be known because your sensors are collecting your data. So here you have an example. There is a prediction that within 2 years, by year 2020, there will be more than 50 billion, so we are talking billion, not million, devices connected. And those devices, of course, are on two sides because they are both sensors and broadly understood actuators. And I'm not talking about networking here because, as you know, there is this new concept of edge computing which is coming, which means that within IoT ecosystems, we will have sensors, we will have cloud, and we will have plenty of nodes with varying heterogeneous capacities that will participate in information processing. And there was a talk about related to a number of Gs. We are talking about 5G, where cars will be talking to each other. And by the way, do you really want to know what cars will be really talking about to each other? It's going to be like this. Hey, my owner was drinking last night and he's driving like crazy. Stay away. Okay, we are staying away. Can you do something about it? No, I cannot, because he turned off the self-driving mode. This is what the cars will be really talking about. But no, nobody's mentioning this for the time being. So, going back, we have Internet of Things, and we have a problem. We have a problem because there is not only fast-growing number of resources, but we have also enormous heterogeneity of data. And Maria will tell you a little bit what to do with heterogeneity of data. And where is heterogeneity of data coming from, by the way? Well, it's very simple. Let's say at the beginning, part of the ecosystem was built by one company, then another company built another part of ecosystem, then the third company, another part of a smart city, let's say Smart City Brasilia. And if over time you have 5 different companies that did different 5 parts of Smart City Brasilia, then most likely when you try to build Smart City of Smart City, those systems will not talk to each other. And of course we have a solution, and Maria will tell you what the solution is. But I will be talking about something else also in the context of Smart City as well. Because what you have is you have dynamic interactions. Dynamic interactions means that you with your phone are moving around. I'm not sure if it already works in Brasilia or in Brazil as the whole country, but in Poland nowadays, if you get to the shopping center, you may get an SMS telling you that if you go to such and such store, there is a special discount for you. Yeah. How do they know? Well, they know because your cell phone, your smartphone is in the shopping center. So the company which runs your network, who is your provider, is of course collaborating with somebody else, and they will be sending you SMS, hey, specially for you, Marcin, specially for you, if you go to this store, there will be 20% off the second pair of trousers. Will I go there? I don't know. It depends if I need trousers or not, but they are trying to get me to do this. And if I get out, the interaction stops. You have fast, you have mobile devices, mobile units, and with those mobile units, you're going to have changing entities that for short times interact with each other. And what can they talk about to each other? Moreover, Internet of Things is going to be about machine-to-machine communication. Humans will be there surrounded by sensors and actuators. For good or for bad, we are building systems in which human is the center, but has less and less to do, other than drinking caipirinha, of course, because you can drink caipirinha at any moment, and this machine cannot drink your caipirinha for you. And this is beautiful, okay? It cannot eat beautiful Brazilian fruits for you. This morning I was eating some kind of a fruit that I have no clue what it was. It was extremely sweet, was falling apart, it was greenish on the outside, whitish on the inside, and it had plenty of black pits inside. It was really cool. I don't know what it was, and it was only me who was enjoying the taste of this fruit. But machines cannot do this. Now, this means that we're going to have plenty of resources, of all kinds of resources, and we're going to deal with access. Now, my access to my resources, okay, we can handle it. But what will change? What will change with the Internet of Things, with the smart cities, smart environments, with networking everywhere, with 5G penetrating our brains all the time? My students are telling me that we should start wearing aluminum caps so that 5G will not penetrate our brains and steal our secrets. I'm not sure. My students are a little bit paranoid from time to time. But you're going to have others accessing resources of others. So what I wanted to share with you a little bit, and this is just give you an overview. There will be no mathematical formulas. This will be just generic, bring you to think about things type talk. The question is how to manage access. And by the way, in Europe now we have a new law, which is very strong as far as privacy is concerned, which means that you should have very strong control over access to your own data. This is known as GDPR, and everybody who is here as a keynote speaker from Europe will tell you that GDPR that was enacted some years ago but came to full effect May 25th this year has effect on privacy control. So how can we deal with access and privacy control? Let's focus on privacy, on access. Okay, the first approach, which is, and this is like, you know, if you didn't know, you didn't think much about this before, here is your basics, okay? The basics are, you have policy-based access control, which means that you have policies that establish, for instance, that you have access to this room. And this information is, you may have some card or some kind of a device, physical, that you're going to swipe, or maybe you come and it's going to be, you're going to look into something and your scan of your eye will give you access. The point is that there will be specific policies establishing who has control to what. Now, the problem is, with this approach is, that management of such policies is extremely complex. Because you have those policies everywhere and they are very specific. So because of low granularity, you have a lot of policies to manage. And then if you have very distributed systems where policies are everywhere, then changing a policy has to somehow be done for everything. And this may be difficult to handle. So some time ago, people decided, hey, why don't we approach it from another side? What we can do, we can specify roles, and roles will be associated with access control. So for instance, if there is at the university, there is a faculty lounge. And if you are faculty, which means you have a card, which is, or some other device that is establishing your access, If on this device it will say you are faculty, then if you come to a given faculty lounge and you press this thing, if it recognizes, faculty, open door. Now look, what's the advantage of this? Well, the advantage of this is simple, because we can have one rule. Faculty has access to faculty lounge for all faculty members, okay? Which means that number of rules should be reduced, okay? Now, of course, this is gonna work as long as you don't have too detailed control. If your roles are relatively large and can capture a large number of people. Now, with roles, also you can capture things like the same person cannot be in two different roles. There may be contexts, okay? So if you are a doctor, you may or may not have access to financial data. Or if you are in HR, you may have access to HR data, but not to some data related to the projects that the person is working in. So you may have different roles, and you can nicely deal with it. So here are some classical examples of accessing, and I should have thought about more power-oriented, so something from smart building, but I put here some examples from medical domain, which are easy to understand. So here we have the situation in which we have this role, physician. Physician is a role, okay? So if you are in a role physician, you have access to all medical data, okay? Do you have access to financial data? This is a tricky moment, especially, anybody here from US? Really from US? You know that financial data in US, especially in medical context, is a nightmare. My daughters were born in US, and because my daughters were born in US, you don't want to know medical bills that materialized suddenly, even though I had quite, as a professor, I had a quite good medical insurance. And suddenly there is a medical bill, no problem, birth, $6,000. What for? Well, all those things which were not covered by the insurance. Okay. Researcher can have access to medical data, but only in anonymized form. Okay? You can establish such role, researcher, and then you have what researcher has access to. Financial clerk can access information about my debt to the hospital, but should not have access to other data. Okay? So roles, easy to understand, yes? But then people who deal with this decided, hey, maybe we should approach it from another direction and be more specific, and instead of roles, deal with attributes of entities, okay? So I will give you an example. This means that we sort of split things and we create vocabularies of attributes. And here is your example. Attending physician is an attribute. Patient's age is an attribute of a patient. There is an age, attribute of a person. Patient's parents or legal custodians, by the way, those will be two different attributes which are very closely related to each other. Because in some cases, there may be that a person has parents and the parents are alive, and then parents are the ones that will be in the role. But it may be also that there are legal custodians for underage. Bad things happened, no parents. Then there is always, for underage citizens, there is this entity which is named legal custodian. Okay? And then what do you have? You have roles like attending physician. So here is your role, attending physician. Attending physician has full access to her patient's data. And if patient is less than 18 years old, parents or legal custodians have full access to medical data. Okay? So we are not going with roles, we are going with attributes. This person has an attribute, legal custodian of this child. Or this person has an attribute, parent of this child. Think about this, by the way, also the capturing the distinction between parent and legal custodian in case of divorces, where you have divorce and there is one parent who is not legal custodian. Things like this happen, and you can capture it then much nicer because the attribute is the right granularity. In this context, there exists something which is named Extensible Access Control Markup Language, XACML. It's a way of defining policies, access policies. It's a standard. The standard version 3.0, this is, by the way, this is OASIS standard. In January 2013, there was version 3.0, and I just found out that in June or July last year, there was an erratum published. So they stayed with version 3.0, but they clarified a few issues. What it gives you? It gives you language and reference architecture for systems that implement access control. And by the way, this is quite popular. What do you have? Okay, you have attributes describing subject, which means who is requesting access. Resource, what the who is trying to access. You have action, what kind of access is requested. For instance, reading would be an access, or entering a room would be an action. And then there is environment, which defines all other attributes which are pertinent to the situation. And here, for those of you who love XML, is a sample XACML request. As you can see immediately, it's XML-based way of defining things. Here you have that Bart Simpson wants a perform action read. Okay? So action read is going to be performed if, of course, the system determines that Bart Simpson has the right to see this data. What do we have? We have also reference architecture. Reference architecture, for you should know, being somehow related to ICT, reference architecture is very important. Reference architecture tells you what the system that you're actually going to implement should have. So what it should have? Policy enforcement point. This is what actually enforces. So this would be like, this is the part of the system that actually opens the door. Okay? So if the decision is door should be open, then the door is open. I mean, think Mission Impossible 1, Tom Cruise is coming, or somebody is coming, and as the eye puts the eye, and the system decides to open the door because thinks that it's somebody else. Yeah, this is the policy enforcement point. Okay, that actually, bam, the door is open. Context handler, this is what delivers information from all possible other resources outside of the system directly. Policy decision point, this is what makes the decision. So it's like the brain of this whole system. Then you have policy information point. This is where the attributes are coming from. And policy administration point, which is where you are storing administration. So this is where you are defining policies, and this policy will stay, this policy will be updated, this will be removed. It's done through the policy administration point. Now, the problem with those is that still managing complex situations with attributes implemented is not easy. So there were already some time ago suggestions to use semantic technologies and take the vocabulary out of the policies and have separate management of the vocabularies. Here, one of the first was the group of Priebe from Germany, but what they proposed was, we believe, step in a slightly wrong direction, because Priebe and colleagues suggested that what needs to be done would modify the referent architecture. And we are saying, hold on, you should not modify a successful reference architecture. Okay, let me make it clear. If XACML has reference architecture, which is very popular to implement systems, and there is a lot of systems that are implemented that use XACML and have full implementations of the reference architecture, then, ladies and gentlemen, we should not mess up with this reference architecture. I mean, look, we may have the best possible proposal, but the legacy systems will always win. Keep this in mind. This is like a thought of the day. Legacy always wins, unless we have revolution and we cut some heads off. Yeah, I mean, the French Revolution, we have some French people here. French Revolution was successful because they removed some legacy systems. They had this beautiful machine, which was named the Gilotine, and this was removing legacy systems from the ecosystem. Okay? If you remove enough legacy systems by cutting their heads off, the system will transition to the new state, and then come back to the old state by restoring monarchy. But let's not talk about this for a moment. Okay? So how can we use semantic technologies? Well, to use semantic technologies, and I'm afraid that I have to do this, and if you understand what ontology is and you have experience with semantic technologies, fantastic, but I expect that with power systems, some people may have a little bit of knowledge gap. So ontology is a specification of conceptualization, which is what was introduced by Gruber, and it's a set of concepts, relationships between them, and machine readable to perform things with them. Here, simplistic ontology, for instance, there is this software already existing, which is named the Reasoner, that can reason on the system and establish that, not knowing it explicitly, that user who is under 18 is underage, that blood pressure is medical data. So what we did, we implemented policy implementation point, policy information point, using semantic technologies. Okay, it's implemented, it's working, and we can share with you if you would like to try semantics XACML. Here, for example, you have a physician may read resources of type medical data. Request comes for blood pressure. Now, there is no policy about blood pressure. The policy is about medical data. But in the vocabulary, you have a clear specification that blood pressure is medical data. Taking this into account, the system will give you access. Okay? Now, the main problem with semantic technologies. Few people know semantics. It's not easy when you build a semantic system to find ontology engineers, because we don't teach much about semantics, there is not much, and semantics is relatively tough. So what do you do? Generally speaking, we have developed our own lightweight ontology management subsystem. It's named OntoPlay because it's built on the Play framework, and it allows you to deal with ontology not knowing that you are dealing with ontology. So in a way, we developed a system which allows you to build interfaces in such a way that a user who does not know ontologies can make modification in the ontology and keep the system going through a nice interface. So here is, for instance, an interface for class expression. And I don't expect you to know what is class expression, but you can see that there is a lot of fields. And generally speaking, you can give it to the worker, explain what you need to do in a given scenario. The worker will be capable of filling appropriate fields, pushing the button update, the green one on the bottom. Ontology will be updated, the system will keep on working because the OntoPlay will upload the modified ontology, so we can allow, using ontoplay, people who are not skilled semantic engineers deal with semantics. Here is the sample scenario. You have an example of an ontology which is represented. Here you have a subcontractor relation, which is important because if you have access to a port and a company which usually has access hires a subcontractor, we capture the fact that there can be a subcontractor. And rule will be contractor is subcontractor is contractor, so it will be allowed. Okay? And we can deal with this very easily. So, to conclude, we have developed two pieces of working software that work with semantic technologies. One is SXACML, which is a semantic extension to XACML, standardized language for writing policies for access control. We have now a module for it that it's a plugin module. You can take the existing module and you can add our module, and it will work with semantics. We have also OntoPlay, which is a lightweight ontology editor, but also front end for semantic systems that allows people who don't know semantics, use semantics, semantic technologies, and use ontologies and delicately modify them. And delicately, I will comment on it in a moment. We use those. Maria's student was using OntoPlay for semantic image management. And it worked very nicely. It was master's thesis. Student, which was really, I put my, me, but it's really Maria and mine, was using both XACML and OntoPlay in port logistics, and a little bit more about port logistics in the next talk. But we need to be very careful with OntoPlay, because unfortunately, I didn't have enough time to tell you this. But there is this very powerful ontology manager software, absolutely fantastic. It's like robust. It can do anything other than cooking breakfast, more or less. It's named Protege, and it's from Stanford. The problem with Protege is that it really requires knowledge. Now, we have lightweight OntoPlay. So people, we can develop systems where people not knowing ontologies can work with them. Just one thing we need to be careful, because we, with new requests, we are systematically adding features to OntoPlay. And we need to be sure that OntoPlay doesn't turn itself into Protege bees, because it is not what OntoPlay is to be about. If we go too far, then we create a tool which is too complex, and we will overdo. Okay? So, finishing, and there was just a card telling me to finish. I would like to invite any and each of you who is interested in trying those or working with us and trying to use those entities in your work, or you have an idea that semantic technologies could be really cool, but you never knew how to use them, how to approach those. We are here till the 11th. And we will be more than happy to talk to you about some potential joint work. And also, maybe there will be in the future another Brasilia-EU call for joint projects. And we tried one, we failed, but we can do better next time. It's Kaizen. Thank you all very much, and this is it.
Okay, so thank you very much for the very exciting presentation. So now we can start the phase of questions, right? So anyone would like to make any question? Okay, so I have a first question. Could you please, because as far as I understand here, the ontology is built by some kind of user or someone related to the system. But today we have the big data, we have a huge amount of data. Could you maybe talk how to make some automated semantic building, if it is possible, if it is not possible, how it would work. Could you please comment more about that?
Okay. Now I'm going to speak with my... I need the microphone because
otherwise,
I need to be recorded.
Yeah, that's true.
Thank you. Brazilian government. I would like to, at this moment, express my deep gratitude to the Brazilian government for supporting my trip here. Now it's recorded, so it's important. Look. There are works that try to automatically extract ontologies from various data sources, extracting ontology from text. You know what? Many people tried, and majority of them failed. Extracting from data streams, it's even worse. I will tell you this. Right now, while we believe that semantic technologies can be extremely helpful, everybody is looking into deep learning, TensorFlows, and things like this, because they believe that this is where the magic is. But from what I'm reading, TensorFlow is almost dead. Yeah, I see on your faces like, what? This is an abomination. Yes, it is an abomination. But if you read, even from Flipboard, news from biggest, best universities, MIT, Carnegie Mellon, they know already that deep learning did what deep learning could. Those who are on the edge understand that we need to go someplace else, because from now on, deep learning will be only incrementally improving things. So you are pointing, through your question, to a very important research direction for the near future, because we believe that things go in circles. Things go in circles in the following sense. There was time when there was interest in neural networks in the 1950s. Then there was time when there was no interest in neural networks. Then there was time of interest in neural networks. Then there was no interest. And now we have again neural networks in the new context. It's spiral development. We believe that while this was an absolute craziness about ontologies and semantic technologies at the beginning of this century, where you have the publication by Dieter Fenzel, Ontologies as the Silver Bullet. Well, maybe this was a silver bullet, but it didn't work too well for the vampire it wanted to kill. So this vampire is still alive. Oh, by the way, is silver bullet for the vampires, or do you need a stick, wooden stick, and it's for the werewolves? Werewolves, okay. So he was trying to kill a werewolf, and werewolves survive. So now we need a new silver bullet, and we believe the time for semantic technology comes back now. With the new development and with technologies like deep learning, we may be able to start going back and maybe reapproach the question of finding semantic representation of reality in data. Maybe it's time to go back to this question, because recently we tried to set a student to deal with the issue of finding ontologies from corpora of text. And what we found out, all the tools that were proposed within last 10 years, all of them are dead. And people who produce them are hiding from emails. I am not joking, okay? You send email to somebody who is lead author of a tool, and this person is like, I don't exist. I am not here. I never was. I never touched it. So time for what you are suggesting is coming, which will be a really cool area to do some research with us or on your own. Yeah, I'm now in the marketing mode.
Okay. Any other questions? Since you are in the market mode, could you please talk a little bit about the type of applications you have used for... At the Academy, Polish Academy, of course, also at the university, right, together with Professor Maria. Just a few applications, I mean.
Okay, so for semantic technologies, Maria will tell you about application in the port, because in the project that we are finishing now. One of the areas was port logistics. The other area was medical data, where the scenario was that you had medical data of various types in various sources and you had to make things talk to each other. Here you have see semantic image management, where you are adding ontological representation of reality to image segmentation software, and you can better ask questions. What else? Now we have also some students who do crazy things. Like, students who recently proposed an agent semantic system for finding the best place to eat the cheapest pizza. The assumption is that pizza places will offer specials of some kinds while people have allergies. So a group of hungry computer science students wants to go out, find a place where they can stuff themselves with pizza up to here and pay the least amount of money while not having problem with allergies to foods, okay? And here the assumption is that your price will be lower if you have more and more of the same pizza. So if you have Hawaiian pizza with meat and pineapples, and you order 20 of those, it's gonna be much cheaper than 20 people orders each a different pizza. So they develop this agent semantic systems where agents are negotiating which pizza should satisfy most people while not sending them into food allergy-induced shock, which would be not good. Okay, so those are some, but come to us with your ideas and we can talk, especially during lunch, which will be after the next talk.
Yeah. So I'd like to thank again then Professor Martin for the presentation. Thank you. Okay, so now let's go to the next presentation of the day before the lunch. I'd like first to introduce Professor Maria Gantz.